But he did wonderfully. Yeah. This will be the first of many. All right? Yes. I will invite Brother Zivas to come up. This is the last Sabbath that he will be with us. And I hope it's for a short season. We'll see what the Lord says, right? And he has been a blessing to me in particular, upstanding young man. And I think we all can attest to that.
Yeah. Amen.
I have asked him to play the piano. And he has been very gracious. And we have worked a few sessions to see how we can put a song together. It has been 32 years that I last sung a song here in the church. Not here, but you know, in the church, 32 years ago. And it was in Southern California. And a 14-year-old played the piano that day. And the last time that I had a special music was November 2019. So I have not sung, I have not sang, I would say, since then. So as we get older, things get rusty. This song, when I came from Brazil almost 33 years ago, the Oklahoma Conference, I sang it several times, kept meeting and so forth. I trust in God wherever I may be. You know, going to Sanibel, the trips that we take, I take the back roads in Florida. There's a little town, it's not even a town. Farming community, and it's called Rialto. The author of this song is buried there. Can you imagine that? Wow. You know, that's he had a farm there. I trust in God.
For me.
My heavenly Father watches over me. My heavenly Father watches over me. Thank you, Zelas. With the condition that I find myself in, I didn't realize that inside of my mouth gets so dry.
Yeah.
So it's raspy. But I think I should get busier singing so I can get back to where I was before.
Yeah.
So
you get better at that. I don't know if we can stand it.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Trust in God.
Amen.
Trust in God.
Amen.
And I want us to think about more than a cliche. It should be a way of life. And today we had testimony. And as Brother Eric was telling us how he prayed for God to give what? Wisdom. And I've been there. While in Irmo, I thought I could do something with pipe. And I went to Lowe's, and then in the afternoon, the young lady that was the cashier there, she says, you know, this is the sixth time that you have come today for the same issue. Don't you think it would have been easier to hire somebody? Trust in God. It was 1899, June 6th. A little boy was born into a family of several, and he became quite a man. Catholic, but practicing Catholic, not just the name that we see in Latin America, practicing. And he had this urge for the Lord. Well, what do you know? In the late 1930s, God sent a messenger to proclaim the three angels' message in this city. And now he's married with young little fellas, and he had this handbill. You remember all of us that are a little bit older in the church? And he looked at it and he says, this is something worth going to. He had his own business, shoemaker by trade. But at that time, he had gotten beside the theology of the Catholic Church. In the quest of knowing more about God, he had gotten himself into theosophy, very deep, dark stuff. At that time, this handbill comes to his hand, and he started attending. 6 months was the evangelistic campaign. There was not a single Seventh-day Adventist in that city. So the pastor that was sent, he had to deliver those handbills door by door. 6 months preaching. And then he became one of seven pillars in the city. He remained about 40 years being the head elder. And this is the gentleman that I am telling you about. That is my maternal grandfather. Of course, when I became of age of knowing my granddaddy, he was already into his 60s. The Lord called him to his rest in 1978. Powerful preacher, a man of God. But since he came to the knowledge of God, not Seventh-day Adventist, to the knowledge of God, he pursued that as his goal. At every step, he put his trust in him. When he decided to go for the three angels message, you know who got mad. And multiple times, the attempt against his life was not even funny. As we grew up and we would go and spend a month or so where they lived, his custom was to get up about 4 o'clock in the morning. 4:30, he was headed to the church. The church at that time had shower and everything there, and he would go there to do his personal study. He would take a shower, he would go to the first pew on the right and sit down there. And there he would plead for himself, for his family, everybody on the church, on the community. One day, one morning, while doing that, he felt invisible hands on his throat. And they were powerful. And he started to choke him. He started being choked. The only thing that he had, he tried to utter a word and he couldn't. He was being asphyxiated. Nobody around. The only thing that he had quick in mind was to open his Bible and with his right indexed finger point to the word Jesus. And the hands let him go. Folks, this is not a fairy tale. This has actually happened to my granddaddy. And he passed all this experiences of what is to trust in God. The summary of his career with the Lord, he told us several times, salvation is difficult, but it's not impossible. And if you think about that, that is the theology. Salvation is difficult, but it's not impossible. Why is it difficult? Because we wrestle against what? Huh? Are you having it easy? If you're having it easy right now in your walk with the Lord, maybe you're not walking with him. Yeah, that's a fact. That is a fact. You get, the closer you get to Jesus, then you're going to see the arch enemy of Christ, Satan, give you what you never thought would come your way. Trust in the Lord, says the wisest man on earth, inspired by the Holy Spirit. Trust in the Lord with what? With all your heart. Why did he put all? All. And lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, what?
All your ways.
Submit to him. And we will make, and he will make your path straight. Why are we having the issues that we're having in our personal lives? Just to think about. Could it be that I am not trusting him wholly? H-W-H-O-L-L-Y? Complete? Steve Chapman, his wife Anne, they wrote a beautiful song. It's called The Secret Place.
I met single one day. I don't know when. The secret place. And it says, the song starts that my heart is like a house with many rooms. And the Lord comes to visit. But there's one room that is locked. Jesus wants to go into that room. But then I am surprised. I didn't think he was going to come that soon. There's a secret place in each one of our hearts. I'm just making an umbrella. Maybe some of you may not have that. Maybe you have it all surrendered to the Lord. But be careful. Be careful. The secret place. The text said, trust in the Lord with all your heart, right? And then the next one, in all your ways submit. Again, the wise Solomon says, there is a way that seems right to a man, but its end is what? Is the way of death. It's a powerful text that I want us to focus and take and digest it throughout the week. You know, in our currency, we have that the statement that we what? We trust in God. Is that so? Let me suggest that if we would, we wouldn't have these social issues that we're having right now in our country. Huh? We wouldn't have the issues that we have at home. We wouldn't have the issues that we have at work, at play, if we trust in God. Could it be that it's just a cliche to make us feel that we're a little bit closer to the Lord? Huh? Listen to this one here. Trust is the fruit of a relationship in which you know you are loved. The scripture says that test all things and retain that which is good, right? So I'm choosing this fellow's statement. Trust is the fruit of a relationship in which you know you are loved. Is anyone loved here by the Lord? Huh?
Yes.
But you see, that love is a two-way street. Huh? Many a times, it's just what? Give me, give me, give me, give me, give me. When it comes to service, nothing. Especially when it comes down to nominating committee. Huh? Can someone say amen on that one?
Amen.
Huh? I'm not telling you lies. You know very well. The best relationship is when you can lay next to each other and just talk about anything and everything. Huh? When at work, we have issues. There's no communication. There's no trusting. I worked in a hospital a while ago. That I say that in that hospital, they don't backstab you, they front stab you. Oh yeah, yes. And it could very well be that the same thing happens at home. That's where relationships just fall apart. And now the thing in vogue now is like, no, we're gonna wait. We're gonna live together and see how it happens. And time goes by. And the church is just as good as it is. But when you see the life of the Apostle Paul, it's different. The Apostle Paul was a bad boy. He was a bad boy, right? But he thought that he was it. But when he allowed Jesus to come into his life and surrender wholly, fully, complete. Now we can see when he is writing to the church of Corinth, of Philippi, that everything, it has come to a situation that he considers it a what? A loss. Loss. He loses something here, but he has gained what? The superior value of knowing Christ Jesus. And he says, my Lord. Trust in God. You trust someone to the extent as how you know that person. Huh? Someone comes in right now here, you know, I don't know him from Adam. So do you think I would trust that person? It takes what? It takes time. It is a dynamic interaction of give and take. But when it comes to the Lord, I better take. Because he knows better. And look what how he finishes this verse. I have lost everything for him. That is Jesus Christ. But what I lost, I think of as what? This version. Sewer trash. As I was putting everything together, I thought, well, you know, some folks are wealthier than my wife and I. You know, we're not paupers. But I have, we have two or three cars there, you know, to move around. Got a trailer. We're still paying a house. If blessed, but if I make those blessings to interpose between Jesus and my relationship, as to the extent that I say that I trust him, but not with a full heart, if I have still a secret place, when I come down to my senses and I look everything that I have, Apostle Paul says, according to this version, should be considered what? He considered it as sewer trash, garbage, dung, waste. It is far better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust any human. Amen. Psalms 118, verse 8. The Lord is your strength and your shield. Trust him. Psalm 28, 7. We are told that in infinite wisdom, God chose the foundation stone. Who did? God the Father. And laid it himself. He himself laid it. He called it a sure foundation. Christ is a tried stone. Those who trust in him, he never disappoints. So why are we going through thick and thin when we have the solution? Huh? Why? It's a personal question. And you know the answer. You know the answer. So why he doesn't disappoint us? He has borne every test. He has endured the pressure of Adam's guilt and the guilt of his posterity. That's you and I. And has come off more than conqueror of the powers of evil. Look at Hebrews 4:15. He has already been tested in every way that we are tested. But he emerged, how? Victorious, without failing God. The King James Version says, without sin. Without sin. Do we get the secret? And we have sung about it. We have sung about it. We have preached about it. We have a cloak that says, I trust in God. But is it? Every soul that refuses to give himself to God is under the control of another power. Do you believe that? Huh? You fail to surrender. I fail to surrender. Another power is calling the shots. He is not his own. He may talk of freedom, but he is in the most abject slavery. You know, these words like slavery have become taboo in our society anymore. But who cares? It is the eternal destination that we're talking about. Huh? The eternal destination. He is not allowed to see the beauty, that's the person, of truth, for his mind is under the control of Satan. How can we remedy that? Trust in God. When you know God, you trust him.
Amen.
Huh? Amen. When you know him, you trust him. And those who know your name put their trust in you, for you, O Lord, have not forsaken those who seek you. Psalm 9:10. Again, the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul in Philippians 3:10, in the middle of the text, says, that I may know him. And I wish this would be something that we can carry out this week. Just, if you can just remind that phrase in your brain, that I may know him. Longing to know the blessed Jesus, the beautiful Jesus. I know that each one of us have experienced him in one time or another. But you know, he's promised, it's a product of dry mouth. He has promised to be with us until the end of the age of the world. Right? So those here and there experiences, he wants us to have it as a continuum experience. Psalm 91 says, 1,000 may fall here, 10,000 here, but to you what? Because you know him. You know him. How is it to be in the mind frame, in the frame of mind of Job, that after he went, and you know, he didn't deserve that, right? He didn't. But even when he is down, when he has lost everything, children, possessions, and everything, and even his wife just tells him off, writes him off. He says, though he slay me, what? Look, folks, Job was not a superhuman being. He was just as frail as you are, and I am. But he had made up his mind that he will put his trust in God. That even when your bank account is wiped away, and you know that can happen, in a blink of an eye, we have the experience. My wife and I have that experience. We didn't get wiped out. But it was horrible that we are scarred now. When everything is, you lose your house, your vehicles, your job is gone. What does the world say? Those are the acts of God, right? Isn't that what it says? The fine print? Yeah, no. Job was there. Far worse than you and I will ever be. Yet he says, even if he kills me, I will still trust in him. Amen. What about the three Hebrew fellows? Huh? When they were threatened by the monarch of the world of that time. Oh, I heard that you are not obeying my orders. Well, tell you what, I'm going to cut a deal with you. And then the response of three Christian men that they had put their trust in God. And they say, King, we don't have to even think about it. He will deliver us. But if he doesn't, we will still not worship you, your image. No man can be his own teacher in regard to the soul's eternal interest. Why do we have issues in our midst? Bucking the system, bucking the word of God. It's because I don't want to let go. That secret place, there's a machinery there that is messing me up. Yet I'm coming with my tithes and offerings. I preach, I sing, I pray. But my heart is not totally surrendered to him. But you can say, but I'm still blessed. Yes, you are blessed. Why? Because the Lord is merciful. Huh? And everything that he does for you and I endures what? For generations. And he says that he sends the rain and the sun to good people and to the gangbangers. Which they have a shot to salvation if they would just listen. No man can be his own teacher in regard to the soul's eternal interest. The only way to escape is what? To trust. To trust in God. To trust in God. I have read some of this lady here. Look what God put in her brain to tell the world. Never be afraid to trust an unknown future to a known God. Isn't that beautiful?
Amen.
Huh? So why do we fight that we want to be in control? What the one that is the architect of life knows your future. Every word of God is pure. He is a shield unto them that put their trust in him. Proverbs 30 verse 5. He's a shield. And let me suggest to you that Jesus is a demon tamer of the entire universe. I liked the allegory that Brother David brought to us last week. The confederacy of demons presided by Satan himself. In fact, he's not that far-fetched from reality. You go to the book of Tempers, and you will see how alcohol came into being. Huh? We don't know because we don't deep in ourselves. Jesus can do everything. Every demon that you may think, the demon of poverty, slackness, the demon of cussing, just to say some of the things. Oh, there's a demon for every evil thing in my book. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall what? Shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. And when you do that, then that person, he or she, you will say, he is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in him I will trust. Are you willing to give it a shot? Huh? Or renew that trust? Huh? No, this is not for everybody. You know, the sermons that we come, that we preach, that we hear, it's not for everybody. Oh yeah, it's not for everybody. It's for the one that wants to, when everything is said and done, walk the streets of gold.
Amen.
And he who was sitting on the throne said, behold, I am making all things new. Oh, don't you like a new, brand new car? I like the smell of a new, brand new car. Brand new house, yes. But far more than that is what God has prepared for you and for me. Also, he said, write this down. For these words are what? Trustworthy, because it is coming from a trusting God.
Amen.
And they are true. Look at this beautiful picture of Jerusalem. That's Mount Zion, right there. Those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be moved, but abides forever. I forgot to put the text. This is a text. Those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be moved, but abides forever. My take to you and to me, trust your present life, trust my present life to Jesus today, and he will preserve it for all eternity.
Amen.
Are you willing to do that?
Yes.
Give him a shot.
Yes.
Let's give him a shot, and you will see how this church will flourish. I am committed. I am committed. Moving forward, that more souls will come to the foot of the cross because of our faithfulness, and that we are having a straight, tight connection with the Lord. Let's stand up. Let's stand up and sing hymn 279, Only Trust Him. We will sing all stanzas. In heaven. Thank you for the admonition given to us.
Yeah.
It's high time for us to let go. And for you to take control. But that is decided in each one of our hearts. And that will determine where I will end up at the end of time. I pray that each one of us that are here and those that will be watching and are watching right now, all of us will make the right decision now, today, to trust Jesus. He is the tried stone, and he never disappoints. Bless us as we continue to celebrate the rest of the seventh day, and thank you for the meal prepared. Bless us as we go from this place. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you, folks. So be